This is Ham Radio Now, episode 210. DMR, an introduction to DMR, digital mobile radio, sometimes known as MotoTRBO. Don't tell the MotoTRBO guys I said that. They get mad at me when I do that. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, sitting here with my co-host, the Bear. Say hi to everybody, Bear. Hi, everybody. I'm the Bear. You saw my lips move. Sorry. Didn't mean for that to happen. This is a forum that was presented at the Dayton Hamvention. Yes, this year's Dayton Hamvention. Don't get on my case. It was presented by John Burningham, W2XAB. I think John is from the Atlanta area. Let me make a note about John's call sign here first, W2XAB. It is not an experimental call sign. Current experimental call signs are 2x3s with an X as the first letter. It's kind of like Tim Allen, his call sign in The Last Man Standing, where he plays Mike Baxter. Mike Baxter is KA0XTT, as in ex-Tim Taylor from Tool Time. Tim has got his own real ham radio call sign now. He's passed his tech test. I don't remember what it is. It was a secret for a little while, sort of a secret. But it's not a secret anymore. But the W2XAB used to be an experimental call sign. It was the original call sign of WCBS television back in 1931. Dial down here just a little bit. There we go. W2XAB. July 21st, 1931, using the mechanical system of color television, or of just television, that, guess what, we don't use today. Got a feeling that wouldn't have gone too far. All right, anyway, so it says on John's QRZ profile that he enjoys the history of technology, and that call sign honors early TV broadcast history, and yes, it's a vanity call sign, which means he won't have to be paying to renew it if the current rule deal stays in effect whenever it's time for him to renew it. Okay, so this is a good introduction to DMR. You might still get lost here and there. And if you do, John has got the a little booklet that's on the web that you can use to reinforce the talk. He'll talk about it a little bit. You see this complicated address here, the turbo.org/doc/amateur_radio_guide. Never mind. Just Google DMR guide W2XAB, and you will need the W2XAB, or otherwise you'll end up some non-ham radio God knows what thing. Okay, so John is going to do the introduction, but I'm going to give you a very short what is DMR, just to get you started, in case you came to this episode from, you know, who knows where, kind of randomly. In case you watch all the Ham Radio Now episodes, John will give you lots more detail. Okay, so DMR is a digital voice system for VHF and UHF. It is a commercial system designed for business radios and designed to be cheaper than P25. But because it's cheaper than P25, some public service agencies, you know, police, fire, and stuff, are using it. And, you know, so much for interoperability. Yeah, I don't know about that. I looked up a couple things. DMR, Google for yourself, DMR for public service. You'll see a lot of interesting stuff. What is it, Bear? Just moving around a little bit. Not ready to jump down yet, but he will be soon. DMR is kind of a force fit into amateur radio from the commercial service. It's not exactly a square peg in a round hole, more like an octagonal peg. You have to round off some of the corners, and then it kind of fits in. An example of that are call signs. The two pure ham radio digital voice systems, D-Star and DSU's Digital Fusion, they both embed your call signs in their signal. You tell them what your call sign is, put it in the radio, and it uses it to identify who you are. It also uses it for doing things over their networks. DMR doesn't, because it's a commercial system, doesn't know anything about ham radio call signs. It does embed its own version of some kind of radio identification. Hams have adapted the system for our own networking and call signs, and John will explain how that works. But it is definitely an adaptation. It's not specifically how it works. DMR's big feature, besides being digital and working pretty well, is that it is two channels in one. And John will explain that in more detail, but very briefly, one radio frequency carrier is literally divided in two by time, spending a few, well, tens of milliseconds carrying one conversation, and then a few tens of milliseconds with the other conversation. So two channels going on in one, two different sets of people yapping at the same time. Your radio sorts it all out for you, so you only hear the one that you selected. And yes, when you transmit, your radio is actually switching between transmit and receive dozens of times per second. Okay, not quite that fast. And the radio fills in the gaps, gives you a continuous flow of audio. You don't hear it sound like that. For the repeater owner, this is like having two repeaters in one, a single radio box, a single duplexer, and a single antenna. And those things are expensive and difficult to get installed in many places. And so getting two channels for one is a pretty good deal. DMR is extensively networked, both in its original commercial service, but in ham radio, particularly in ham radio. Many repeaters will typically link to a worldwide or a national network on one of those, what they call time slices, and it'll be on a regional, a statewide, maybe a local network on the other. The way I understand it, my understanding of DMR is limited. The way I understand it, the user can't control what network the repeater is going to be connected to, the way that a user can on D-Star, and we still don't quite know how it's all going to work on System Fusion. But I did glean from John's talk that there is a way for a user to select a talk group, he'll explain what that's all about, that maybe lets them route the system to where they want instead of just hanging out on the repeater's network. I didn't really understand that very well, so we'll see what he explains, and maybe I'll learn a little bit more about it. DMR is kind of complex. I remember my D-Star learning curve. The first radios I got, there's one back there, the 9280. Well, the first one I got was an ID800 and an ID91, IC91 handy talkie. One of Yaesu. Whoa, sorry guys. One of ICOM's first handy talkies for D-Star. So I got those, and they were a mystery. They took some time to learn to figure out all the D-Star stuff. Today, there are all-day classes that you can take. There's one just before Dayton to learn all the details of D-Star. Is DMR that complicated? I don't know. In this introduction that John is going to do, you're certainly not going to learn everything that you need to know to get a radio up and running and to start using it. But you'll get some pointers for resources that will get you there if you get interested enough and that's what you want to do. Just like D-Star, hams take shortcuts to get their radios on the air by having them programmed by a friend or another more experienced ham. And they may learn more about it after they get on the air with it, or they may just keep on using it. That happens in D-Star as well. I'm still not using DMR myself, mostly because it's yet another radio, and I think I've got enough radios, because there are no purely ham radios yet doing DMR. I don't think there's any dual band radios. I could be wrong about that. I'm kind of waiting for the radio that will do all the digital modes and analog and be dual band and cost under $200. Yeah, good luck on that last part. But here in my area, the Raleigh, North Carolina area, and North Carolina in general, it's very DMR oriented, more than D-Star. There's been D-Star in some of the metro areas. Here in Raleigh, far more DMR activity than there is D-Star. I hate that it has to be a choice, but at least for right now, it still is. So maybe I will end up there sooner or later, but I still want that real all-mode radio. And look, a new definition for all-mode radio. All digital modes. Okay, so before we head to Dayton, Arvin, sitting back there, the chief financial officer for Ham Radio Now, would like to get in a couple of plugs. The first one is our Kickstarter. This is for going to shoot video of the ARL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference coming up in October. in Chicago. Would like very much to go. It all depends on reaching our goal. It's $10,000 goal, and 25 days to go. It ends at least, you know, as I sit and look at it now. But in hard dates and numbers, it ends on July 31st. We are just under $3,000, so we've got a ways to go. But usually these things kind of fill in the last week or so. So we'll see what happens. If you're interested, stop by hamradionow.tv and you can click on the button. I got it. Got it up here. Yeah. The Kickstarter button is easy to see. So you just click on that. It'll take you over here to the Kickstarter page. I don't know if there's ever been a DMR talk at a Tapper conference, digital communications conference. Of course, Tapper is all about open source, and DMR, it's a proprietary commercial system, but it has been adapted to ham radio, and there are hams and Tapper who are curious about anything that hams are doing with the digital stuff. They like to learn. The D-Star guys made several presentations about D-Star when it was a fairly new system at the Tapper conferences. And I don't think it's too late to submit a paper and get scheduled to give a talk. I think you still have time to be able to do that. Stop by tapper.org. So are there any DMR experts out there that are willing to give that a try? Tell you what, I will personally ask Bruce Perens to keep the heckling to a minimum. If you're willing to do that. All right. Again, the link to the Kickstarter page is, it's right here at the top of the Ham Radio Now page. So, not quite the top. It's near the top. You'll see it from the top. And second, Arvin would like me to remind you that Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So if you enjoy the stuff that we do, if you learn something about it, stop by. Once again, hamradionow.tv. And click on Arvin's icon. There's Arvin's icon right over there. Whatever it's worth to you. Wait a minute. Never mind that part. The Kickstarter has a firm cutoff date, July 31st, and a fixed goal, $10,000. So, look, if you're interested in helping out Ham Radio Now at all, then go to the Kickstarter and make a contribution there, assuming you're watching this before July 31st. If not, HamRadioNow.tv and Arvin. And now back to those thrilling days of yestermonth. And we head back to the Dayton Hamvention, and here is John Burningham, W2XAB, an introduction to DMR.
Well, I'd like to welcome you to the Dayton Hamvention. How many people came from out of town? Anybody here from Dayton? We got one or two, okay. The presentation is Introduction to Digital Mobile Radio and the Status of the DMR Network. Can everybody hear me? Okay. I'm John Burningham. Current call sign is W2XAB, and I've had a whole bunch of other ones throughout my life. This is like the 40th year I've been here at Dayton. I'd say I hope I have 40 more years to go, but I seriously doubt that. Okay, the Amateur DMR Network. We have over 1,200 registered repeaters around the world. There's close to 15,000 registered radios. Now, that doesn't mean users. That means registered radios. The number is a little bit less than that when you count users only. And the networks are basically divided into two infrastructures. One is MotoTRBO, which is the Motorola Solutions product, which is probably about 95% of the repeaters. And the other is Hytera. They both basically do the same thing, except the two networks are not currently interconnected. I'm going to speak mainly about the MotoTRBO side because I'm not that familiar with Hytera, okay? DMR Mark, Digital Mobile Radio Motorola Amateur Radio Club, really not, it's more of a loose association of individuals, some who used to work at Motorola, some who do work at Motorola, and some who never worked at Motorola, who wanted to implement this DMR technology on the amateur networks. DMR Mark handles the registration of radios and repeaters no matter what network they're on. So if you buy yourself a new radio, you need to go to their website and get registered. There's some other large groups that service the United States. One is DCI, Digital Communication Interconnection, which is turbo.org. And then we have the DMR North America Talk Group Server Project. And there's other groups in Canada, in England, in Germany, the rest of the world, okay? We also have regional groups. It sounds like the organization structure of most, you know, smaller clubs. We have state groups. We have regional groups that cover multiple states who build networks, and then the networks are interconnected with other networks. What this MotoTRBO network really is a network of networks. Sounds like the internet of everything, in case you've heard that term. The network is made up of basically three tiers or three levels in the model of the network. Down at the bottom, we have the individual repeaters. How many people here have a repeater? Okay. If they're connected to a network, they're somehow connected to an access bridge. Some of the common bridges used are C bridge from Rayfield Communications and TLNet from Bridgecom. By the way, both products are exactly the same. They're made by an organization called RavenNet. The access bridges where the repeaters connect into then are connected into other access bridges they have interconnects with, and also to what we call the core bridges. DMR Mark runs two core bridges, CC1 and CC2. The purpose of running two of them is if one fails, all the access bridges switch over to the other one. So we have redundancy. The North America Talk Group Server Project also has a primary and secondary bridge for redundancy. And then DCI has a single bridge. And in North America, that accounts for most of the larger talk groups. A lot of the regional and state talk groups are hosted out of access bridges. And so when somebody on repeater one wants to talk to somebody on repeater six, the traffic from repeater one goes to their access bridge, goes up to one of the DMR Mark access bridges if it's on North America talk group, and goes over to another access bridge, and they get interconnected. Now to get back to some of the basics, how many people here do not have a DMR radio? Raise your hand, okay? See, we have all different types of groups here, right? DMR was developed by the European Telecommunications Standards Institute, ETSI, and it is the worldwide standard for professional mobile radio. It's not an amateur standard, okay? It was designed for commercial, business, government. And we divide DMR into what we call three tiers. Tier one is a single channel specification, which was originally designed for the DPMR 446 service in Europe. It's single channel frequency domain multiplexing, 6.25 kilohertz bandwidth. It has three different modes. One is peer-to-peer or radio-to-radio. There's a repeater mode and there's a link repeater mode. And now tier one has been expanded into radios to be used in other services other than the DPMR 446 service. Now the hams, I hope no one offends to me calling us hams, which is kind of the standard for the amateur networks, is Tier 2. It uses a two-slot TDMA, time division multiple access. It runs on a 12.5 kilohertz channel, peer-to-peer, and repeater mode. It gives a spatial efficiency for each of the talk channels to 6.25 kilohertz. So each repeater has two talk channels. So you can have two simultaneous communications going on the repeater at one time. For those that have repeaters, in the old analog day, one repeater was one talk channel. Today we can put two on the repeater, which saves us on duplexers, feed lines, and antennas. And each time slot can either be used for voice and or data. Most of the amateur implementations are using voice on both time slots. The standard for DMR does not specify how the repeaters interconnect over the network. That is proprietary to the different manufacturers. That's why we have a MotoTRBO network and we have an iTERA network. A Motorola's calls theirs IPSec, IP Site Connect, which allows the repeaters to connect to up to 15 other repeaters over an IPSec fully meshed network. Now, to get more than 15 repeaters, you have to go through a bridge that bridges one network to another. We also have Tier 3, which builds upon Tier 2, which adds trunking so that you can have multiple repeaters at a site, and when a user keys up, it will assign them a channel and a time slot for their communications, which is typical in the larger business systems. Someone asked me today out in the DMR Mark booth, well, why haven't hams implemented Tier 3? And I have a very simple question. It costs about $25,000 per site for the controller. So unless somebody's got a lot of money or wins the $100 million lottery and wants to fund it, we're probably not going to see it in the amateur market. And the Tier 3 protocols, again, are not 100% compatible between brands. In order to digitize the voice, we use what are called vocoders. DMR currently uses the DSVI AMBE Plus 2 vocoder by agreement of the manufacturers. It is not specified in the ESTI standards. Basically what happened, Motorola picked the AMBE Plus 2 and everybody else just followed along so their radios would be compatible. One of the features of the Amber Plus 2 is that it has forward error correction, which means that bit errors in transmission can be corrected, which is an improvement over the older vocoders, such as used in D-Star. DMR two-slot TDMA, said before, occupies 12.5 kilohertz bandwidth with a spatial efficiency of 6.25 kilohertz. 6.25 kilohertz is only using about 25% of the bandwidth that we see on the typical analog FM system. We have two time slots. So it's one frequency. With TDMA, we have two time slots, time slot one and time slot two. And the radios are designed to pick out which time slot you're on so that you listen to the correct time slot and receive. For the repeater operator, it's more cost efficient per talk channel. Typically, across the amateur DMR network, and I say typically, it doesn't mean everybody complies because each little network goes out and does whatever they want. We typically see the wide area talk groups on one time slot and the more local talk groups on another time slot. To get a little bit into how TDMA works for the more technical people, the uplink from the radios, portable or mobile to the repeater, uses a 30 millisecond window for each time slot. There's a 60 millisecond, and of that it uses 30 milliseconds. And it further divides that into 27 and a half milliseconds for the data frame and a 2.5 millisecond gap for some control information and timing. This means when your transmitter, when your handheld or your mobile is transmitting, it only turns on for 27 and a half milliseconds every 60 milliseconds, which extends battery life. How many people always complain about their batteries are going dead and they need to recharge? You know, it's a common problem. Using this two time slot and only transmitting 27 and a half milliseconds out of 60, we conserve power. The DMR repeaters, the downlink, transmits a continuous data stream that includes both time slots. Now, one thing that's a little bit different from DMR is the radios are almost effectively full duplex. When you key your radio to transmit, you send information to the repeater saying, I want to transmit. And the repeater will tell you you can go ahead and transmit. If they don't, you stop transmitting. We also use this 2.5 millisecond uplink for what they call the cache burst or common announcement channel, which is used for channel management and load speed signaling. The frame, which was 27 and a half milliseconds, we break it down further. Well, there's a total of 264 bits. We have 128 bit payload, 48 bits of sync or embedded signaling, and a second 108 bit payload for a total of 216 bits of payload per frame. The vocoder must take the 60 milliseconds of audio with forward error correction and compress it down into 216 bits for transmission. The 2.5 millisecond gap is a guard time and also allows for PA ramping and propagation delay. Now, some of the terminology in DMR, which is some of it's new to amateur radio, some of it's old. We have what are known as talk groups. Talk groups are a way for a group of users to share a time slot. In other words, a one-to-many operation without distracting and disrupting other users. So if your radio is programmed to listen to only one specific talk group and someone is using another talk group, you will not hear them. It should be noted that only one talk group can use a time slot at a time. But you do have two time slots. If your radio is not programmed to listen to a talk group, you will not hear it in most cases. Now, stop and talk about talk groups. We have talk groups for North America, where if you key up on a North America talk group on the network, you will key up a large number of repeaters in North America, United States, Canada. We have worldwide, which keys up repeaters possibly around the world, if they're listening to it. Then we have worldwide English, worldwide German, worldwide French, worldwide Spanish, worldwide Nordic. And I apologize for any of the worldwide groups I left out. I don't remember them all off the top of my head. And again, if your radio is not programmed to listen to it, you will not hear it if it's on your repeater. We also have what are called zones. Basically, zones are just ways of organizing channels on your radio into groups. Some of the radios have zones where you can only have 16 channels in it. Others, you can have larger number, more channels. and you can have multiple zones. Some radios support two zones, some support 32 zones, some support almost unlimited number of zones until you run out of channels. Think of it like a zone is like a folder on your computer where you organize your files. That's all it is. It's a place to put the channels, and then you can select the zone and go to it. We also have color codes. There are 16 different color codes, 0 through 15. One is the default. Color codes are similar to CTCSS, or digital coded squelch. For those in the Motorola world, PL and DPL. You have to have the correct color code programmed for your radio in order to access the repeater. The primary purpose of the different color codes in the business world, if you have multiple repeaters in the same area on the same sharing of frequency, you would use different color codes on each one. I think most of the ham repeaters are color code 1, although there's a whole huge variety of them. The use of color codes is not optional on DMR. You must use a color code. Otherwise, the repeater will not acknowledge you. In the Motorola world, we talk about code plugs. In the commercial radios, by FCC rules, the users cannot program their own radios from the keyboard. They have to use some type of interface, cable, and programming software. The code plug is basically the personality of the radio, where you configure the talk groups, the channels, the frequencies, the time slots, the power levels you want, your mic gain information. Encryption is available. And by the way, anybody here from Canada? Yeah, we got a few Canucks. Is that what they call them up there? In Canada, they can use encryption. In the United States, we can't. In some of the European countries, they can use encryption. In the United States, we can't. So if you're in the United States, don't use encryption, or you get in trouble with the friendly candy company. If you want to build your own code plug, it can take many hours. I built a code plug for a CS700 radio a couple of weeks ago because a club I'm involved with down in Georgia went out and bought about a dozen of the radios. And of course, nobody wanted to program their own radio. So I programmed about 600 and some channels, and it took me like 40 hours to program it. I don't sleep much at night, I guess. And, you know, then I posted it on my website, and they can download it and put it in their radio. Of course, the first time they wanted me to load it into the radio, you know. The code plugs can also contain a list of radio IDs. In the DMR world, you have to get an identification. It's a digital number that's used on the network. The radios that have the displays will support a database listing the radio ID and then the call sign and names you want to be displayed. So when someone keys up, instead of just seeing their code, you can see their call sign and name. But that's built into the radio. That's not carried over the network. D-Star carries the call sign over their network. DMR does not. You can find a lot of code plugs out there on the web, the starting point. Some of the talk groups on Yahoo have them and some others. All the DMR radios support a limited number of entries in the contact list. 1,000 used to be the maximum. The new CS750 is supposed to support over 10,000 with some future software upgrade. We have scanning on the radios. Everybody here should understand what scanning is. You program in a couple of channels and your radio scans between them until it finds something and stops. Not very different than we do in analog. We also have on some of the radios in DMR, we have what's known as roaming. Now, roaming is not scanning, it's different. Roaming allows your radio to automatically select a better channel if the current channel's RSSI received signal strength falls below a certain level. Now, it doesn't find the best channel. It finds the first channel in the list that is above the minimum. So if you're in a major metro area where you have a large number of homogeneous repeaters, and as you drive around, the radio can automatically change channels for you. Of course, then you don't know what channel you're ever on, but it works. It requires that all the repeaters carry the same talk groups on the same time slots. Also, for it to really work efficiently, the repeaters have to be programmed to send out a data burst at regular intervals so it can measure signal strength. Otherwise, if there's no activity on the repeaters and you drive through the area, it may not automatically switch and you may drive out. You have a question back there?
Is that a stable frequency or are each repeater on a different frequency
pair? Each repeater is on a different frequency pair. Roaming is not supported in all the radios. In some radios, it's an additional cost option. Personally, I don't use roaming. Where I live, we're not oversaturated with repeaters, and I always know what repeater I normally want to be on because it's in my vehicle, and I'm never too far from my vehicle. In order to get roaming to really work well on the network, the repeaters have to beacon, which sends out a short announcement every so many seconds, so that the roamers can identify which repeater has, you know, their signal strength. And again, roaming does not select the best candidate, it selects the first candidate as you go through. We also have simplex. How many people use simplex? You know, I was talking to someone yesterday who was driving cross country to get here, and they were listening on 5.2 simplex, and they managed to cross the country and never hear any traffic. Okay. In the DMR world, most of the professional users refer to talk around. Talk around, which is an option on the radios, allows you to transmit on the repeater output frequency. Most hams don't do this. We use simplex and we have dedicated simplex frequencies. Now, nobody agrees on anything. Everybody agree with that? See, that's the one thing we can get people to agree on. Nobody agrees on everything, okay? The DMR community basically got together and selected and recommended some simplex frequencies to use. For UHF 4410, 4465, 446075, which seems to be the most common, and 43345, which is common in the non-North America countries where they can't operate up in the 440 to 450 band. On VHF, they picked here 14579 and 14551. They use talk group 99, color code 1, and it's all on time slot 1, with a MIC criteria to be always and in-call criteria to be always. We haven't talked about a MIC criteria yet. Now, of course, most simplex on DMR is short range. The MIC criteria. On your analog radios, you can key up anytime you want, even if someone's talking, right? Sometimes call that QRMing. The emit criteria we recommend be set to color code free, meaning it doesn't hear a repeater with a different color code. And it makes your radio polite to the current system. And your in-call criteria is basically follow emit criteria. Whereas simplex, we say transmit whenever you want. Now, what this means is if the repeater's up and somebody's using it, you can't key up. When we talk about accessing a DMR repeater, you must have the correct frequency, color code, time slot, and talk group set correctly. When you key your transceiver, you send a signal to the repeater, and the repeater responds back to acknowledge that you can transmit your message. Otherwise, you will be denied access, and your radio will typically, as I like to refer to it, give you a bunk to let you know you didn't access the system. It may give it to you because it's out of range, the repeater's down, or somebody else is using the repeater on another talk group. Or the repeater happens to be identifying in MCW, in analog mode. One of the advantages here of TDMA is this bi-directional communication between the user radio and the repeater when transmitting. The repeater can also signal your radio to stop transmitting. If there's contention or collision on the network can tell you to stop. The interconnection of the repeaters with IPsec and the bridges, as I said before, IPsec is a vendor-specific feature. They recommend not more than 15 repeaters, and it's not really 15 repeaters, it's 15 devices, really. One repeater must be the master, and the rest are peers. The master's duty is to inform the connected peers of how to communicate with the other peers. So if you're a peer repeater, you connect to the master. The master tells you how to connect to the other peers. And then we have a what's called a fully meshed network, where if you're in an IPsec network without a bridge, and there's 15 repeaters, every time a user keys up, your repeater sends out 14 data streams to 14 other repeaters. The bridges are used to connect IPsec networks. Today, it's common that the repeaters connect directly to a bridge instead of utilizing a fully meshed network. This way, they only have to send one data stream. It reduces their bandwidth requirements for the repeater site. I operate my portable repeater over Verizon 3G network. I have another repeater site where I can't get internet connectivity at. I'm using WiMAX in the metropolitan area for my connectivity. And I can tell you out in Hawaii, some of them use satellite connections to get internet. The bridges basically sit between the IPsec networks and relay traffic to other IPsec networks connected to the bridge, and then they relay the traffic to other bridges, which in turn relay the traffic to other repeaters on other bridges. For MotoTRBO, RavenNet Systems is the developer. Rayfield Communications sells it as a C-bridge. Bridgecom Systems sells it as an MVDMR. It's a Linux-based application, and you can purchase it either in a hardware configuration with software or a virtual configuration where you put it on your own hardware or on a virtual server. This happens to be the de facto standard in the Americas. In Europe, we see some Smart PTT, which is a Russian product. It's Windows-based, and it was common in Europe, although more of the Europe are switching over to the bridges from RavenNet. Now that brings us down to the user radios. There are many manufacturers of user radios. Currently, at least I haven't heard any change today at the HamFest, nobody makes an amateur DMR radio, per se, and is selling it. They're all professional type radios, sold for the commercial services of which hams use it. Now, I remember when I first got back into repeaters back in the early 1970s, everybody had Motorola and General Electric handhelds because there was no ham gear. So, kind of come full circle. Currently, you can't walk into most amateur radio stores and buy a DMR radio. How many people here shop at HRO, Ham Radio Outlet? If you actually go to their website, they sell Vertex DMR radios on their website, but they don't have them in the stores. By the way, I own no stock in HRO. If you want to purchase a new radio, you have to find a dealer in most cases. If you want to buy a Motorola radio, you have to find a Motorola dealer. And there's a couple of ham-friendly dealers. Now, when I say ham-friendly dealers, they'll sell to hams at a reduced price. I will tell you, if you go to some Motorola dealers and you want to buy a radio, they slam the door on you. They don't want to deal with you because they want to sell you a repeater and 50 radios. You know, hams are too much trouble. But there's a few hams that are dealers around. If you search the websites, that will make you good deals. If you want to buy new, you can buy used radios. Anybody here buy a radio on eBay? Search on eBay. There's used radios all the time. I bought radios on my local shopper. I actually bought radios on Craigslist. If you want to purchase a new radio, prices range from about $200 up to about $800 for the handhelds. Of course, the Motorolas are at the top end. Motorola also makes cheaper price ones. You know, Kinect Systems has them down about $200. And TYT supposedly is going to be selling one at less than that. I haven't seen one. When you're buying a radio, here's things you need to think about. First of all, external amplifiers. My best suggestion to you is don't try using an external amplifier on a handheld. Can it be done? Yes. If it switches fast enough, but remember that 2.5 millisecond time delay, as you move further from the repeater, you can get into issues. It's because the transmit, when you're transmitting, it's keying on and off, you know, every 60 milliseconds. And not only does it have to key off, it has to switch back so you can hear the signal coming back from the repeater so you can access it. If you need more power than a handheld, consider purchasing a mobile. Some suppliers of DMR radios. Motorola Solutions, although you can't buy direct, you have to go through one of their dealers. Hytera, Vertex Standard. By the way, Motorola Solutions owns Vertex Standard. We got Kinect Systems, BFDX. Notice I have Kenwood up there. Kenwood sells DMR radios in the rest of the world, but they do not import them into North America. There's been some rumors that they may do that. We'll see what happens. Question back there.
It's about the Kenwood stuff. I visited the Kenwood booth earlier, and their product development folks said that they actually made a new model for the North American market that drops the price on the DMR radios lower as compared to the European model.
So they're planning on coming out with one in them. Okay.
Right. They're coming for one, not ham specific, but the DMR portable and mobile radio for the U.S. market that is not the same as the European because it's less expensive.
Well, what he said is he talked to someone in the Kenwood booth and they said they're coming out with a DMR radio. You know, doesn't surprise me. You know, ICOM has D-Star, Yaesu has Confusion. By the way, I did buy one of the Fusion repeaters for $500. It's making a nice paperweight on my desk at the moment. Okay, good operating practices. DMR networks are a little bit different than what you may have been used to. Because of the talk groups, if you come on and say, this is W2XAB monitoring Southeast Regional, you need to let them know what talk group, because someone may have their radio on scan or listening to a bunch of talk groups, and they need to know which one to go back to you on. Or my favorite one is people come on and say, you know, W2XAB listening, and no one comes back to them. Well, if they want to listen, I don't want to interrupt their listening. Or something like N5ITU, this is W9JW on North America, or this is W0YNT for a radio check on local, or W8FXJ, this is W8SCT on Ohio State. So when you do, you put out your initial call, make sure you identify what talk group you're on. Makes it a lot easier for people to know how to get back to you. Spend most of your time listening, not talking. Be a good neighbor and don't hog the network. Move off the wide area talk groups, such as North America and Worldwide, if you're going to want to have a longer queue cell. Well, there are a number of what we call push-to-talk or user access talk groups that if you get a hold of your friend on North America and they're in New York and you're in Arizona, you can make contact on North America calling and then say, go to TAC 310 or go to UA English 1 or English 2, and then only two repeaters will be tied up and other people can use the network for other things. Hold on, Mikey, we got someone here with a question.
Yeah, I'd like to know if you would elaborate a little bit on using the push-to-talk groups, the TAC channels and whatnot.
If your repeater is connected to a bridge that supplies them with the push-to-talk channels, or I call them, you just key your mic once and it turns that talk group on that repeater. And typically it will time out after a period of time. So you can't get on these and use them to call someone, because if they're not listening, if it's not turned on their repeater, they're not going to hear you. So you make contact like on North America, in the US, and then you, or on one of the, maybe your regional or state, and then you move off to a private talk group so that you can carry on a conversation and only tie up maybe two repeaters or three repeaters. Does that answer your question? Okay. Don't over ID. Remember, in this country, you only need to ID every 10 minutes. Help new users develop good operating practices. When they're doing something wrong, correct them. You don't have to be nasty about it. Just say, hey, you know, this is the way we do it. And the most important is promote DMR to your friends and enemies. I've published last year this booklet, The Amateur Radio Guide to DMR. It's available online, free, at dmrmark.net and at guide.turbo.org. And if you go out to the DMR Mark booth here, which is over in 449 in the ballroom, we have some free copies you can pick up. If you're new to it, the PDF files that are available online are updated more regularly than the actual printed copies. You know, if you're new to it, read the book. Okay? It's free. For those that have repeaters or are thinking about getting repeaters, here's a picture of the new Motorola SLR 5700 repeater. It's available for shipping on June 1st this year. There's one ad in the DMR Mark booth if you want to physically see it. How many people here have an XPR 8300? Raise your hand. How many people have an 8400? How many people have an M3000? Well, here's a new one. This sits between the 8400 and the 3000. I'm told that the amateur price is about $200 more than the 8400.
What's the street price on this on
the 8400's street prices from friendly Motorola dealers are somewhere just below $1,800. This, I assume, will be just about $2,000. Question?
Yeah, quick question for you. So what new features does the SLR 5700 add?
It has more memory. It is 1 to 50 watts. It's what they call a Gen 2 repeater, Generation 2, where the 83 and 8400s were Generation 1. It's in a smaller form. It's 1U in the height. It's 100% duty cycle for transmit at 50 watts. Other than that, there's room for them to add other features later on. There's a place where they, it looks like they're going to have a second Ethernet port possibly for something, and GPS. And you're going to input a higher reference frequency clock information, which is probably not very important for the amateur community. Did you have another question?
Yeah. So it's still compatible with existing C-bridges?
Oh, it's 100% compatible.
Okay. All right.
It's just, no, you don't have to get rid of your old and buy new. Although I think I will start selling my older stuff and see if I can't upgrade the new stuff. Questions? Okay.
I have two questions. The first one is about your roaming. Does that actually effectively change the zone automatically on your radio? How does that work?
I really don't know.
Okay.
Roaming is by channel.
Oh, it's by channel.
And I...
So it could be two channels in the same zone. Maybe.
I don't do roaming, okay?
Okay.
I can help with that.
We got someone who knows the answer to that.
I have a second question.
I'm not know-it-all, okay?
The roaming will take you between the zones, no issue there. You just have to have the same talk group in all the zones, obviously, and it will take you through. Next time you change the channel, it will drop back to the zone you originally was in. So it's only going to roam there, and then it's going to come back.
Thank you for that. The second question has to do with private calling. How does that work? Is it similar to D-Star where it'll find the person or?
No, it doesn't find the person. They have to be on the same talk group.
Okay.
And a private call connects you to them and other people can't hear it.
Yeah, so it ties it up, but they can't
hear it. It ties it up, but they can't hear it.
Right, okay.
Unless you have certain optional software in some radios.
Yes, and then you listen. Or listen to all anyway. Well, maybe not. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much.
Another question. Do you have any usage statistics about DMR versus D-Star in terms of the market? Who's using what? You put up DMR usage statistics there. How does that compare with D-Star usage?
I do not know. I can tell you on DMR, most of the traffic is local. Let's admit, what we use most repeaters for are intercoms, locally. You talk to your friends all the time. And that accounts for probably about 80% of the traffic. I don't know what it is on D-Star. I got rid of all my D-Star equipment a couple years ago.
All right. My question is, you mentioned early that the DMR was originally done in Europe as a format.
The standard was developed.
In Europe. Whatever happened to Tetra?
Tetra still exists, is still used in Europe, and it's still legal in the United States. Tetra in the commercial end in the United States, the problem is Tetra uses a 25 kilohertz.
Right.
And in the business end, getting too adjacent 12 and a half kilohertz channels is almost impossible in the major markets. Now, hams could do it, but then again, that's all different radio, different technology. And that gives you four time slots instead of two.
John, it seems like the Europeans are being a little bit more experimental than we are here in the U.S. For instance, they've got D-Star crossover into DMR. They've got Fusion crossover into DMR. We've got some very strict rules with the DMR MARC network, such as no private calls, and it has to be a Motorola to Motorola. Do you see that breaking out this year or next year as more users come on, or are the Europeans going to run by us?
We have talk groups in the United States with Fusion and All-Star and Echolink. They already exist. They're not on the DMR MARC network. That means that DMR MARC doesn't want that traffic on their talk groups that they manage. Part of the problem, and I don't want to get too editorializing, if you have a full quieting analog signal, it vocodes fine. If you get a lot of static on an analog signal, noise, with the audio, the vocoder doesn't do a good job of converting it. That's the problem. It's like an Echolink. When someone comes in on Echolink from a computer, they sound really good. When they're on an analog repeater and they have a noisy signal, they become almost unintelligible. If you want to really hear something that's unintelligible, convert a National Weather Service radio, because they use an old voice synthesizer, I think back from the Apple IIe days in the 70s or something, or 80s, and it just doesn't vocode well. And that's the problem of the vocoder. Another question. While the forum is free, we do charge you an exit fee. Otherwise, you have to stay here all night. For those interested in the DMR MARC booth, we're raffling off a gift certificate, or whatever you want to call it, for $500 off a MotoTRBO repeater given to us by Ken Bryan, who's one of the friendly ham radio dealers for Motorola. So if you want to buy yourself a repeater, you can save $500 more. If you search the web, there's a number of friendly ham radio dealers. I mean, in a lot of areas, there are Motorola dealers all over the place, okay? If you got club members or the comment I'll make about the repeaters and most of these radios, you're never going to repair them. You don't have the test gear needed to service the radios. If you want the test gear, you're going to start out at about $35,000 for the service monitor that can service the DMR radios. So if you buy a new repeater, I would suggest you get the extended warranty, so that if something goes wrong, they fix it. It's not like the old days. I remember with the tube radios and the GE Master 2s and the Motorola Micors and everything else, you could fix them. There's very little to fix. Everything is down to a modular level. If something goes out, you replace the module. Now you can buy the modules and replace them yourself, but it'd be a lot cheaper to have a service contract or extended warranty when you buy the repeater. Any other questions? We got another one?
How do you find out if there's a repeater in your area, if you're in a small area, not in a big metro?
If you go to the DMR-mark.net website, and up on the top it says repeaters, you click on it, there's a pin map that comes up for the whole world that shows most of the repeaters, not all. It's the MotoTRBO network. It's not Hytera. And there are also some MotoTRBO networks that are not shown because they're not interconnected to the network for whatever reason.
Can you spend a minute and speak to the wide area network bandwidth requirements, VPN configs, that sort of stuff for a repeater?
Motorola has a network design guide. If you're connected directly to a bridge with both time slots, you need about 55 to 60 kilobits per second of bandwidth. Does that answer? It's not that great.
Another question here.
And John, you mentioned Generation 2 equipment before. At the consumer level, is that just deal with the repeaters, or is it something that we should be, what does it mean to the consumer, Ham?
The first generation are the older radios. The second generation are the newer radios. And guess what? Someday they'll have a third generation. It's just...
Any additional bells and whistles on Gen 2 at the handheld level?
Not really.
Thank you.
You had a slide that mentioned programming cables and programming software, but is that free or did you have to go to a dealer?
Motorola charges you about $360 for a three-year subscription to their software updates and their programming software. Vertex is free. Most Hytera, some of the dealers sell it, some will give it to you. Connect Systems posted on their website, and you know. Let's put it this way, the more expensive radios charge you. You have to remember, in the business world, they don't want users programming their radios. I mean, that's the bottom line. Any other questions? Like I said, Mike, do you want to go to the back of the room and collect $10 from everybody when they exit?
How'd that $10 thing go for you there, John? You know, if I were any kind of a computer hacker, I would find figure out a way to have Ham Radio Now take over your computer or your phone or your tablet or your Chromecast or your Roku or whatever you watch us on and keep playing the show. Oh, not just one show. We'd play multiple shows for you. But you couldn't do anything else until you fork over $10. Or go to the Kickstarter if it's before July 31st. Unfortunately, I'm not a hacker, so I can't do that. It's all on you. Maybe then, though, I will be able to afford a DMR radio, and I can have yet another handheld radio hanging off my belt and get my picture on the top of the Ham Sexy website. If you guys at Ham Sexy will link to Ham Radio Now, won't you? You put my picture there, won't you? Okay. That's it for this episode. Everybody's heading for DMR. We'll see you there. KN4AQ, Gary, over and out.